Guys, heavy breather.
I heard the voice of God.
Yes.
Someone gave me a mango and a peach.
Mango and a peach.
Wow.
This is kind of great. This is not kind of great. This is great. So here we are. This is watching the work on the God line. And I'm Suzan-Lori Parks. This is a this is a meta-theatrical free writing class. It's also a play. And here's how the action and the dialogue goes. First, for 45 minutes, we will together create the action of the play, which is all of us will be working on whatever we want. And then in the time after we finish working, after the timers go off and Drew's getting up for time, we'll create the dialogue of the play, which will be you asking questions about your work and your creative process. Emphasis on your work. Okay? So is that clear? Any questions? We're going to work for 45 minutes. Then we're going to talk for as long as we need to. I think these people lined up for Shakespeare in the Park. And I tell people, they lined up for even better.
Have you seen Designated Man?
Oh, it's Russians. Oh, have you seen Designated Man? If you get a chance, they're always awesome. Anyway, okay, so we're going to work for 45 minutes. People in the world, JD's behind the camera, and this is true, and people in the world of the interwebs might want to tweet us with their questions.
Indeed. You can tweet us at WatchMeWorkSLP with the hashtag NewPlay.
Thank you very much. And so here we will go. We will work some. Ready?
Thank you.
I
using all my technology today. So that was the action part. Now we're going to do the dialogue part, in which you might want to ask questions about your work, your creative process. The way we're going to do it is we're going to, you'll ask me a question, and I
actually working down there, they're doing real work. I mean, ours is pretend work, ours is play work, actually. But they're working, and right at this moment, every Wednesday, they refill the ice container.
This is very cool. So what we're going to do is you're going to ask the question, I will repeat it into the mic so that everybody can hear it, unless you're like Dan. Is that your name? Yes, Dan can project like a mofo. So I won't repeat his question, but the other of you, I probably will. So anybody have a question or an answer? Or both? You do? No.
This, like, is it too loud? Was that too loud? Was that a little too big?
Thank you, Jay. Anybody? Yes.
Mine is kind of a conventional question, but it also could really use your strategy.
Sure.
Trying to balance being an artist with all the everyday pull in your life, do you have any strategies for?
Yes. What is your name?
Yolanda.
Where are you from? Are you from New York?
I'm from D.C.
You're from D.C. Are you visiting here, or are you?
I'm really a New Yorker for like 30 years.
Right. I'll see you. So Yolanda has a question. Did everybody pretty much hear her? Conventional question? Okay.
Yeah, so how to balance her artistic life and her artistic commitments with the everyday, like everything from maybe I gotta do the laundry to I gotta take the kids to school to I gotta move the car from one side of the street to the other to I have to maybe a day job or a night job or something like that. Is that kind of
and friends and
Friends.
Good deeds. Yeah.
And good deeds.
Good deeds. You know, like you.
Yeah, sure. Volunteer work.
Well, just even like, you know your friends are down at the dump, so do you stay work on your own work?
Right. That's good. Right. So maybe friends meet your friends want to hang out with you and stuff, and you want to spend time with them. Well, that's right. Need your friendship. Right. Things like that. So just keeping up your friends. Your friends are good. Now, did you guys run back? No. So this is what I do, and maybe some folks gathered here might have some ideas also. Because everybody here, I'm sure, gets work done and has other things to do. What I do is I schedule. And it sounds like, you know what I mean? Because we're taught, we learn from the movies and stuff that, you know, poet, you know, the writer with pretty always like a guy, a white guy with his quill pen, and the inspiration comes and it just kind of comes. But for those of us who are different than that, we make schedules. And so pick a time every day that you're going to commit to working on your art. Okay? Try to pick a time that where you feel fresh and positive, you know, so if you're a morning person, maybe choose some time in the morning. If you're a night owl type, choose some time in the evening. If you're a person who really gets going around 3 p.m., you know, I don't know who that is, but, you know, pick a time around 3 p.m., okay? Okay, so pick kind of a time that's in your favorite time. Make it a manageable amount of time, 45 minutes, an hour, something that you can manage, something that isn't overwhelming to you, all right? And stick with it, and show up for your work every day. So if your writing time, for example, is from 6 to 7 in the morning, every morning, show up every morning. If you have something going on that day, like you're flying out of town or whatever, maybe move it a little earlier, or make sure, or do it at the airport, or find it, you know, another hour, do it on the plane, whatever, find that hour. Daily practice is key and is through the motions? No? Daily practice keeps you up every day. And your friends, if they need you, say, you know, not between 6 a.m. and 7 a.m. You know what I mean? Or if your kid, you know, I have a toddler, right? What I do, I get up before he does. And then he started taking off his diaper. He's like, Mommy, I mean, he doesn't listen. But like, yeah, Mommy, I'm awake and I want your attention. So he started taking off his diaper. So now I go, I went and got some diaper pins. God, pin it on. So, he's in the crib, right? He's in bed, occupying himself. Should he wake up before 7 a.m.? You know what I mean? So you can make the time.
Okay, does anybody else have anything to add to that? Anything else working?
Yes, Carol.
That people don't realize that you're working, and that they see you, that you're sitting and staring. So I have to actually say, I'm still working.
That's really good, yeah.
And also, if you do, I'm sorry, no. If you do laundry, you know, some of the chores are laundry and stuff, that's good thinking. You use it for part of your work and count it.
That's really great. That's really great. So sometimes you have to tell your loved ones, your family folk, hey, I'm working over here, I'm not just, you know, staring, I'm not just staring at space. Okay, I'm working, and sometimes combining work with a household chore like doing the laundry, you're down there in the basement or at the laundromat watching the laundry go, or in your home if you have a laundry machine, watching it go, you can work while you're doing laundry. You have a television set. Ah, how much TV do you watch a day?
Very little.
Good, maybe cut that back to even less. So if you watch, say, 30 minutes a day, cut it back to 15 minutes, you'll have magically 15 hours.
My schedule is never the same every day, so I count. So whatever hours I do write, I keep track of, so that at the end of the week, I know if I'm writing or if I just think I am.
Ah, great. So Jeremy, Jeremy has a schedule that's very, every day is different. So what he does is he tracks. So you say you have an hour, a writer's quota, say. Like you want to do, like a marathon runner, if you're training for a marathon, you want to do, say, 40 hours a week or 20 hours a week. So you want to make sure you get to that by the end of the week. Is that? That's a really great idea. That's a really great idea. Yeah. Anybody else have an idea?
Yeah. Actually, I have a question.
Oh, yes.
Okay,
go ahead.
Okay.
Did you have an idea?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Okay, go ahead,
spell
it.
Do you want to go first?
No.
Oh, me?
You're related, you're answering.
Yeah, I found that if I do something right as I'm about to leave the house, it actually weirdly does this thing where it gives you an internal deadline. Like if you're going out to dinner with your friends and you're like, I've got to meet my friends in 20 minutes, so I've only got 5 minutes to get this idea down, and then you get it, you know what I mean? And so it gives you this like really weird deadline where there are real stakes to it, so then you can sort of just like, and then somehow because you've given your brain, creative brain, a deadline, it sort of answers the problem for you.
That's great.
If that makes sense?
That's good. Yeah, yeah. So create a deadline, or if you have an event that you're going to, I have to do this creative act before I do that. That's a great thing to sort of get something done quickly.
Yeah.
It kind of puts you over long periods of time, you want to find ways to work in a more, we're ultra marathon. Artists are ultra marathon. You know ultra marathon? They're out in the desert, like Death Valley, and they're running 100 miles or whatever. And we want to train so that we can run like that. Because that's the artistic life. So while sprinting does help.
Yeah.
And it's great.
Sure.
It really, you know, gets you to the finish line. We want to create something that's also, in addition to sprinting, we want to create habits that allow us to be sustainable, like everything. But that's good. That's good.
Yeah. All right.
Well, but no,
yeah.
That's cool. I mean, creating deadlines. We
yeah.
can also create deadlines. Like, I ask people are working on a draft, when do you want to be done? And they say, next week. I go, okay, let's break it down and see how you can get that next week. That's all, I always create deadlines. I just created a deadline. I created a deadline at the beginning of July, and I finished it one day early yesterday.
Yeah, holy crap.
So always create deadlines. Those really help. That's great.
Yeah.
Okay, but your question, totally related.
Hi. So I'm also from Washington, D.C. I just moved here a couple weeks ago, so I'm still figuring this all out. And in D.C., I created a theater group. It was an all-female theater group. So
right.
Where I introduced material based on women and women's issues.
Right.
So in doing that, I'm used to writing material that is with just solely women characters.
Right. Right.
And maybe in the last like year or so, I started writing stuff with and introducing men into
right.
the pieces. And sometimes I feel like that when I'm writing male characters and I'm writing a female character in the same scene, for example,
right.
that the male character comes off as stronger. And I don't know if it's just because I'm more excited because I haven't written male characters for so long or if it's something subconscious or whatever the case may be. But I was just wondering if you have any, tips or just any like insight on that in terms of just in making sure that the female characters, male characters, they're not, you know, unbalanced.
Right.
They're both strong characters.
Right. Okay, what's your name?
I'm Star.
Star. Okay, so Star's from D.C., and she's writing, right now, she's writing a piece with male and female characters in it, and she notices that her male characters seem to be stronger in a scene. And any tips you might have to sort of make the characters more balanced, make the scene more balanced. I would say this, maybe it's not about male, female, maybe it's about what the characters want. If you just take it out of the, you know what I mean, for a moment, willingly suspend your disbelief, like the great poet said, right? And imagine that maybe you have more of a hook into or an understanding of what your male character wants than you do of what your female character wants. You see what I'm saying? So he can go, oh, or your female, because he knows, oh, I want to connect with my left arm, oh, to the wall, right? And she doesn't really know what she wants to do. So she's kind of like this, okay? So go back and look at that, because I imagine that you can write strong characters if you know what they want and, you know, sort of move them in the direction of what they want. Try that, because there's no sort of secret in writing stronger men or weaker women or stronger women or weaker men. It's not about that. It's really knowing what your characters want and allowing them to go there. Like we said the other week, 2 points make a line. That's a, I keep forgetting this geometric. It's a given in geometry. Someone knows geometry. Do you know geometry?
Not really. don't ask me any more questions.
I said it before. So 2 points make a line. So the same thing works in playwriting. Your character, where is your character? Point A. Where does your character want to go? Point B. Those are the 2 points. Make a line of dialogue. Okay? So you're probably, so check out, am I strong? Am I clear about where my female character is? And am I clear about where she wants to go? And see if that helps. You know what I mean? See if that helps you. And if it doesn't, then we'll try something else.
Okay. Thank you.
Anybody? Yes.
Is
that on?
Can it be? Is that okay? No, is it not good? All right, great. Sorry, I'm from that. Oh, I'm from that techie generation where we try to save everything.
I always ask permission, but I'm
sorry. I'm from Maryland. Well, that's like almost. What part of
the
sound?
It's Alex
Tamina. I just wanted to know, like, what kind of music do you listen to right now?
Right now?
Yeah, like, what are you into?
Because I am learning, I was just actually looking at that. I'm learning a Reverend Gary Davis tune. This is me talking about my world, which never happens, but I'm learning a song called 12 Gauge in the City, so I'm listening to it a lot. He's a great guitar player, and it's really hard it's a hard song to learn.
Yeah.
So.
Are you learning to play? Do you play guitar?
I do.
Both
hands.
Do you find that helps with your writing?
I don't know, it might not. It gets in the way. No, because when I play, it's also hard to type. So
I know that, I got that. Yeah, I know it's, yeah.
Yeah, but it helps, sure, it can help. I mean, I don't know, it probably ruins it. I don't know.
I don't know.
Well, yes.
Are there any non-writers?
I'm on point.
I'm an actor.
She So, but it's interesting. Life is interesting because, you know, I ran into you a week ago on the street, and so I wanted to look to see what's happening at the public, and I saw that you were doing something live, and so I came and I didn't know what to expect, you know, because I knew I had this time in my child care's cover, so I wanted to just come and like check it out, and I thought maybe it was going to be like a, where we observe you writing, or we were going to talk or something like that, and then computers and the writing, and then I text him like, is there a theme? Because I assumed, okay, this is writing. Everyone is writing. It's not, you know. And he said, no, write whatever you want. And so writing for me as an actor is something that I figured wasn't my lane. I've been avoiding writing. I'm not going to say how old I am for a long time because I figured, you know, okay, that's not my lane. And so what I want to share with you all is that, okay, this is what the project is, and I'm going to sit here and I'm going to write something. And instead of like, okay, oh my God, what am I going to write about? I was like, let me write about just how I'm feeling right now. And because there was, I actually came in with a stomach ache, and I decided to write about it. And now my stomach ache is gone, because I had to deal with the source of why I was having the stomach ache. And so I'm just grateful to be here and to observe and to hear from writers. I love writers. And I don't know what's in store from that.
Well, they say theater is, you know, one of the healing arts.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's so true.
So there you go. Thanks for writing. You know, and the theme, actually, there is a theme. The theme is write whatever you want. That's actually the theme. Freedom.
Yeah.
Do your thing. There's that quote, who said that, do your thing so that I may know you? Someone said it. Thoreau or Emerson? I don't know, I get them confused. But do your thing so that I may know you. Anybody else have a question? Thanks for all.
Yes.
I think it was interesting because why did you respond to the stomach ache? It's like, you told me that he was simply imitating the sound that the stomach made.
Can anybody hear you?
Oh.
I tend to edit as I go and have those moments where you're like, nah, no, new word. But sometimes I find that that, particularly in these kinds of exercises, can get in the way where it makes you want to go back and try the whole first paragraph again or, you know, rewrite that whole thing. And I'm just wondering if people have thoughts about, I haven't really come to a conclusion about whether it's better to edit as you're going or to step back and not touch anything and just let it be sort of brainstorming with extra structure. So I'm just curious about what you and others feel about that.
Yeah, I do have strong feelings about this. I would suggest to write and then rewrite. I said before, there are two kinds of courage, the courage to write and the courage to rewrite. Okay? Writing in the garden where anything goes, everything grows. Rewriting, you're on that white, my horse is white today. White horse with the sword of discrimination and your favorite Beethoven music playing, and you're going through the field cutting everything that doesn't fit. Right? Two separate acts. Okay?
I would suggest doing that. And this, the exercise for today is a replication of what you could be doing every day in your writing process. So it should be no different than your writing process. We try to make it, I mean, you can imagine us all here. I imagine you here, and I'm writing. But okay, so I would suggest write, and then rewrite. And what happens is you have that inner critic in your head, and they come up in a variety of forms, and you'll hear people saying things like, gosh, my mother always calls when I'm writing, or gee, I get nervous about the dry cleaning when I'm writing, or I don't know if my writing is good enough. You'll hear people say all these kinds of things. It's all resistance to doing your work, okay? And resistance is basically some form of fear, which is basically a form of lack of faith. So it's all the same thing, no matter if your boyfriend always knocks on the door and says, hey, baby, come back to bed, we're not writing, whatever. It's all a form of the same thing, and your job is to just continue, regardless, okay? So practice, part of your practice can be just keep going. Come on, you're an ultra marathoner. What are you gonna do? Oh, shit, I gotta rerun mile 47. Come on. There you are, through the desert, through Death Valley. You got the number, you know? You sweat, you got the sunscreen on, whatever. You continue forward. You rewrite later. Okay, when I get to the end, then I go back and I rewrite. Okay? That's what I do. And people have other takes on it, but that's sort of what I suggest. Anybody have a session?
What's your opinion on the need for playwrights to write and have a message, or to write something that means something? I like to write, but sometimes I don't want to fucking have a message about what I'm writing. Sometimes I just want to tell a good story. What's your take on it?
Yeah, what's my take on playwrights or artists needing to have a message? You can tell, because I make kind of a face when I say it. I think messages are great things for the audience to think about after they've seen your play. That's the audience's job, or the critic, scholar people, right? They'll go and they'll say, whoa, his play, what's your name?
Chris.
Chris's play was about the both of them. Chris will say, or well, not really, but I was telling the story of my mom and dad back in the 70s, or whatever, you know what I'm saying? So whatever, that's cool, but I lean on the side of tell a good story. If you tell a good story really well, it will have a strong quote-unquote message, because that's how we understand things these days. You know what I mean? I find that when things have a strong message, that's kind of all they have. You think of plays I really love, like King Lear. It's got lots of messages about fathers and daughters and kingdoms and growing old and fools and blindness. And you name it, there it is. Or Hamlet, right? I think if it had been written with a message, that's all we'd be getting. Just one message, which is kind of, meager. So I like to tell a good story and then just let people go, I think it was about this. Well, I think it was about this. That's cool. That's fine.
What do you feel the differences between TV writing, film writing, and playwriting, and not just in terms of from a business standpoint, but in terms of what you can do with all those artistically? Does that make sense?
Yeah, it depends what kind of TV writing. The difference between TV writing, film writing, and playwriting, it depends. If you're writing for a network like a sitcom, it comes down to time. Mm-hmm. You gotta write certain time, sort of segments to actually fit in the form, okay? There are certain restrictions on what you can do in those time buckets, with cable shows, there's a lot of more room now than there was 5 years ago.
Yeah.
There's a lot more freedom. Theater, it's live. And there's, to me, nothing something that a living person can come up with other than people pretending to be somebody that they're not. You're just all that life is, actually. It's like,
I'd say
whoa,
so.
There it is again! Life! You know what I mean? I mean, and that's kind of fun. And there you are sitting next to somebody, and somebody's over there. Or you're standing, if you're watching, you know, your last love, you're standing up and doing things, you know. But, you know what I mean? So there's something to be said for live action. But TV and film are cool.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it's all good. It's all writing.
Yeah.
It's all hard.
Yeah.
Sure. It's all difficult. You know, it's all the same kind of thing, process.
Had several discussions. Can everybody hear me?
Yeah.
Where are you from?
Chicago.
Can
everybody hear me?
Yes, go ahead.
I've had several discussions with people here and other places about form.
Yes.
I've had discussions with people about how it's somewhat harder. This is all in theory, but it's harder to be Lemon Anderson at the Public Theater than it is to be Macklemore and achieve grassroots success. So can you talk a little bit about, before you were Suzan-Lori Parks and you were trying to get the plays made, about like bringing, bringing new form and thinking about theater, because even though we're doing theater in front of a live audience,
right,
we often lean back on how things have been done. So about bringing new ideas and not only new stories, but new ways.
Right.
And how that, like that struggle and or if you're doing the commission, how you
right.
kind of fit within the confines.
Right, right.
Does that make sense?
Cool. Yeah. I mean, how to bring new forms. I mean, you're a new artist wanting new forms. I mean, you're a new artist who's interested in new forms.
Yeah, just in how we move. I mean, everything from like, one extreme is like sleeping more, right? One extreme is improv everywhere. One
right.
extreme is Anna Deere Smith. One extreme
right.
is the conventional plays we know.
Right.
Gats are
right.
right? So
right.
playing the new ideas, what do you struggle with or what do you find is process when trying to take a new idea to a theater who wants something that says like, oh, well, this is universes. Here's a hip-hop play.
Right.
Or here's Regina Taylor. Here's a black play.
Right.
Or here's a blah, blah, blah. When these boxes are constructed,
right.
how
right.
do you deal with that when you, as an established writer,
right.
you have a new idea, want to do something new?
Right. Well, so I mean, two questions. One, what do you do when you're starting out or you're sort of making your way in your career and you are interested? I'm sorry, I'm trying to think of.
I gave you a lot. So.
No. It's a couple things. One, I never tried to write anything that quote nobody ever seen before. I never thought I'm going to write something that nobody's ever seen before. I never tried to do that.
But if it's authentic to you.
Yeah, but I just try to tell the story the best way I can. You know what I mean? So I saw reality as I saw it and tried to write the story as I the best way I could. And then people said, that's such and such and this and that. They labeled it. And then it was able to get produced where it could. Okay? I'm one of those people who doesn't spend time trying to control what she can't control. So people make labels for things. Oh well. People want to put things in boxes. Oh well. You know what I do? I write the best writing that I can. And I'm kind to the people around me. That's what I can control. I can't control what so-and-so and such theaters and blah, 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 blah. I can't. So I just focus on my writing and my craft. You see?
So you're writing outside the confines of what anyone else expects of you, even if it's a
yep.
commission.
Yeah, you're right. Sometimes you're writing and people don't expect because they think you are, they put a label on you. You should be writing like they put a label on you. And your job is to write the best, do the best writing that you can do. And it will find its way. It will find its venue. It will find its home. I have no doubt. You see what I mean? So it kind of takes them out of the equation and forces you or us to put a focus on us. We have to think about what we're doing. We can't be thinking about them. That's like thinking, what will the audience think of my play? The audience. The thousands of people who will see your play. What will they think? It's a lot of people, right? I just focus on me. What is this word right here on this page? See what I'm saying? It's a little, it's, But it's basically controlling what you can control and kind of letting the rest go. Drew's waving at us, which means we have to go.
And I have to get the mic back.
And we have to get the mic back.
Because they're like, ah!
Okay. Jet. Okay.